Hey y'all, it's me, Kimberly Clark, and I am here with an exciting reaction video, I guess. I'm a drag queen here on YouTube, but I also perform live. And as the world is beginning to open up because more and more people are getting vaccinated, thank you, I am able to return to the stage again, back with American Utopia, David Byrne's incredible Broadway show. We'll be at the St. James Theater, starting performances September 17th. Figured as a kind of thank you and as a kind of homage to live performance, I would watch my favorite clips of me performing live, in person, in the real world. Before I do that, let me just say thank you to all my patrons out there. If you want to support me, this channel, and these videos, go ahead and check out my Patreon. Become a patron of mine, as little as $1 per video, but you could pledge as much money as you want per video. Will really help me out and really make these videos more viable. Make them happen. Huzzah! Okay, but without further ado, let's just share some love for live performance, right? Okay, here we go. Let's get started. Woo! Oh God, it's gonna be an hour. Jesus Christ, okay. Here's the first one. So this is my drag debut that I did. Yeah. So I had just figured out how to do drag for this number. This is. I'm very proud of this still. This was at a performance night called Catch at a theater space in Brooklyn called The Invisible Dog. Love it. This is a Tina Marie song. It's called Portuguese Love. Tina Marie is one of my faves. Also, can we clock first time in drag performing with 7.5-inch placer heels? On a very uneven floor, may I just say. This theater space used to be a factory that made those invisible dog leashes. And so it's like a kind of very rustic floor. Okay, so this was a collaborative performance. This is my dear friend Elizabeth Dement playing Marcal, my Portuguese lover. This is my favorite joke. This is so dumb. I ain't gonna let you go. Like. And then we meet my other sister, Georgia Pacific, played by Erin Maddox, another incredible dancer. I love lip syncing Tina Marie. She's such a weirdo. Ugh. Oh, choreography, come on. This is, you'll see me coming up. I'm about to almost twist my ankle. Here we go. Oh, I fully fell out of my shoe, but luckily it was behind somebody's head so you can't see. Get ready for a cannon. 7, 8, 1. 1. 1. Flip, flip, get it. Right, this is my favorite part of the lip sync, when it's two Tina Maries just scatting. Oh, and then I take out one of those Eos lip balms. Shaker. Que hora es? It don't matter. Come on, Tina. I'm actually like overwhelmed. Like if you look at me, like that's I didn't know what it was like to be, to do this and get that reaction. This was the beginning. Okay, this is a clip from Minnie Horowitz's YouTube channel. She's a drag sister of mine from New York. Hey girl! This is one of my signature numbers. We are in the basement of this shitty little bar on the Lower East Side. And I love performing for thousands of people. I love performing in huge spaces, but I live for performing in these tiny little spaces. Oh, here's the gag. So if you don't get it, this whole number is about cultural appropriation. Miley Cyrus, a Jay-Z song is her song. That t-shirt, by the way, a Get It t-shirt, it's from WGI. Woo! So I love this number. I've done this number a lot, and I've known that other queens have done a similar concept to this. I was unaware of them doing it before this. I may have been the first. I'm just saying, if you see another queen ripping off this idea, proof is on the internet. January 10th, 2017. This was a New Year's gig, I think. Yeah, it was New Year's Eve. Email my heart and say our love will never die. Okay, that Britney Spears song, the way I found it was I found a list. Someone ranked all of Britney Spears' songs from best to worst, and that was the worst. Email my heart. My song. Okay, this is the best gag because this next part is not planned. This just happened. So Cotton Eye Joe plays, right? Okay, watch, watch. Look. I noticed these two women were just doing the dance. And I was like, come on, come here, come here. Come on to the stage. Okay, and this is what's great. People like Max, who's filming it, don't know that this is a dance. And so just listen to her reaction. She thinks I like secretly coordinated a dance number with these two random women. Little did she know that the Cotton Eye Joe dance, if you're a genial like me, it's in your blood. This is the proof. I love it. This was the only, I performed this many times. That was the only time when people did the dance. I tried other times doing it to try to get people to do the dance, and that was the only time. I just want to say thank you to those two ladies out there who were wasted and just thought they just didn't realize they were part of the show, and I really appreciate you. That's real community there. Okay, moving on. Oh, okay, this one. I didn't watch this yet. I watched a lot of these before tonight, but not this. Okay. Night of a Thousand Stevies, legendary night of Stevie Nicks appreciation, organized by Johnny Dinell and Chi-Chi Valenti. This is in New York City. They did one in New Orleans that I actually subsequently performed at, but this was the first time I performed with my sister, Severely Mame. The concept of this whole number was Johnny's idea, Daddy. Hey, Daddy. You know, it's like a Christine McVie song, but Stevie just sings the backing harmonies and the chorus. Severely Mame plays Christine McVie. I play Stevie Nicks. So the whole gag was that every time Stevie sang, the audience would go crazy and no one would pay attention to Christine, and so she wasn't lit. You could hardly see her, you could just see a crinoline. But the videographer like clearly didn't understand that that was the number. So as soon as I walk on stage, he just zooms in on me. So you miss all of Severely Mame's like incredible like pantomiming of anger next to me. Anyway, it's still, I think, incredible to watch it. This was at Irving Plaza, I think, is where this was. And so, like, now it's like, it's not supposed to be all about me. It's supposed to be that she's in the dark, but she's singing. But the video really just zoomed in on me. Doing my vocal warm-up, drinking my tea. Okay, this is where we get some of the drama. Look, Christine's like, put the spotlight on me. Okay, and then this is a super inside joke. I mean, I take out a slice of Sara Lee pound cake because Stevie Nicks, in this very famous interview, or I thought it was famous, talks about addiction being like eating trying to eat one slice of Sara Lee pound cake. It's kind of like if you tried to eat one slice of Sara Lee pound cake, and then you have another slice, and then you have another slice, and before you know it, you've eaten the whole cake. I thought, if anyone's gonna recognize the Sara Lee pound cake reference, it's gonna be Night of a Thousand Stevie's audience. No one got it. I ate the pound cake and then I gave it to someone in the audience who, she was so confused. I'm chewing pound cake. There's pound cake in my mouth. I love it. I love it. Okay, this one. So this is me trying to sing a Dolly Parton song at a gig at Union Hall, which was a bar in Park Slope, Brooklyn. Now, for some reason, my track didn't download all the way, and it's like in a basement, performing a lot of basements, I guess. So there was no internet to download the full track. And so what happens is my music gets cut off, and you see what I end up doing. Now, this is a song that's like a very creepy horror story narrative song that is actually a Dolly Parton song. It's so weird. Watch the whole video. I won't give it away, but I just want to show you the part where the music cuts out.
Ain't you got no gingerbread? Ain't you got no candy?
Oh, dude. What happened?
Ain't you got the track for me?
I love watching clips like this. I love things that happen live. They're just so good. Like, you couldn't make this up. Like, maybe someone thought I scripted this or something, but there's so many incredible things about live performance, but like, one of those things is like, shit like this happens, where it's like, people just have to figure it out. Problem solving.
I mean, I could play it.
I mean, I could play it. Luckily, Fantasy Grandma was performing and they had a Casio on stage, so I...
Can we do that? Is that okay?
Hit the power button, baby!
I am so motherfucking multi-talented, you don't even fucking know. Some of you know. Some of you are my YouTube subscribers. Subscribe!
I never played this before. This is my first time playing it. Luckily, it's three chords, so it was easy. And this is how Dolly does it. If you want to see, if you think I just made this up, Google Dolly Parton performing Me and Little Andy live.
Ain't you got no gingerbread? Ain't you got no candy? Ain't you got an extra bed for me and Little Andy? Daddy came the baker's man. My mommy's ran away again.
I love this song so much. Okay, one of my favorites. Clearly, maybe some of those people knew that I could play piano and sing. Maybe some people didn't. I clearly surprised them that night. I got to do some gigs at Pete's Candy Store, which I really loved. So I'm a huge Tori Amos fan, and I love this clip because it's a super small room. It's super, super intimate, so you could hear everybody. And you could hear my friend Aaron Markey, who's an incredible performer, when they realize what song it is. They get so excited.
So I want to kill these women.
I believe it.
it, girl.
I'm so motherfucking multi-talented, you have no idea. Oh my god. I love this song so much. Under the Pink, second album, classic. Ugh, Tori. Hey y'all, it's me, Chris, and as I was editing this video, I was having some trouble kind of making the transition from Kim's gigs to more of Chris's gigs. And then also, my husband pointed out to me very lovingly that I had neglected to include any clips that feature any of my own compositions, any music that I wrote in this little retrospective. That was curious. Anyway, I figured to kind of remedy all of that, I would insert this bonus clip. This is a clip from a benefit performance that we did at Joe's Pub, hosted by Kimberly, and featured the music from shows that I wrote for a theater company called Half Straddle in New York City. Tina Satter is the artistic director of that company. I've worked with her for years. She wrote the lyrics to this song. And Kimberly is playing the mother character in a show called Family. It's a role that was originated by the incredible actress, Racy Wright. And I'm presenting it to you without any chit-chat, just to give us a break from the jibber-jabber as well. Enjoy. This was a piece that I was the associate choreographer for by the composer David Lang, and Annie B. Parson choreographed it. It was a 1,000-person choral piece in Lincoln Center. I also performed in it. I was kind of the dance captain of one of the groups. It was this incredible piece to organize, and it started out as like this very kind of like secret performance. And then it started to get a little bit more organized. And then there was whispering, and then speaking, and then singing, and then clapping. Oh my god. You could watch this whole piece. Simon, he was our incredible conductor. Simon Halsey. I think David Lang wrote the lyrics to, I think the lyrics of this piece came from like auto-completed Google searches of like, what do we share? And it was like, our free will, our power, our need. time, our capacity. This was incredible. It was like 100 degrees. It was in August. It was in the Plaza at Lincoln Center. But it was so moving to be a part of this massive experience and to be the person that really helped translate it, you know, translate this movement score that Annie B had in her head to like really help implement it. It's one of my favorite things to do. I love translating ideas, and especially to people with different skill sets. So these were all choir members, chorus people. And we had them doing all those gestural choreography and stuff, and every single person involved in it was so incredible. If you were one of those 1,000 people out there, I'm just so proud of us. You all did such an incredible job. And this is stuff that you forget about that happens, like these kinds of performances. You know, it's not about Instagramming it or making a soundbite or anything. It was this live, incredible, beautiful experience. Look, there's Annie B and David.
Hey.
I wonder if you see me. You have to watch the whole thing and find a little moment of me. What a wonderful event. When I first started like watching clips for this video, it was very moving. It was surprisingly moving. Yeah, I didn't know how affected I would be by like reliving some of this stuff. This was one of the earlier times that I worked with David Byrne before performing with him on tour. I was the associate producer of an event called Contemporary Color, which was a color guard rock show. Different musicians like Nelly Furtado, St. Vincent, Tune Yards, Money Mark and Ad Rock, Lucius, like Deb Hines, all these incredible artists to write new music for color guards to perform their routines to, and then we performed it at the fucking Barclays Center in Brooklyn. And this is a clip of the finale from that event. Oh my God, it was so fun. There were 500 Color Guard members. And this is the little unison bit they did at the end. Again, this is one of those like events where I like was like a translator. I was like the go-between between the music world and the color guard world. I was captain of my high school's color guard. No, we did not go to WGI, we were not that good, but I knew the world a little bit, and so I was able to be this kind of translator between the different parties. This was so much fun. If you were there, give me a shout out, let me know. We also did it at the Air Canada Center in Toronto as well. Okay, so now we're just full, we're full David Byrne. Okay, so a couple clips are performances from American Utopia. So this is, again, this is from the tour of American Utopia. We did 144 shows in like 126 cities or something around the world. This was at a festival called Rock Werchter in Belgium outside of Brussels. I'm just showing you the opening just to get the scale of what it was like to do these gigs. I mean, the Hudson Theater was the smallest venue that we performed at, which is where we did our Broadway run. So this was more along the lines of the sizes of crowds that we were performing for. The show starts with David at a table holding a brain. This was the clip when I watched it the other day. It made me cry just because it's indescribable to talk about what it's like to perform at a festival like this, with a piece like this. I filmed this video after my other video because I knew if I cried, my makeup would already be ruined. You don't see me enter, but there I am, that's me. This song is a really beautiful song too. It's from his newest album, American Utopia. Look at me. This is just, it's fucking insane that I did this. Die. My heart tore, man. I mean, it was just a trip, man. 80,000 people, like, we did Lollapaloozas. We did Okay, and then this gig, this is Born Under Punches at Forest Hills. So Forest Hills Tennis Arena, the last time that David Byrne performed there was the year that I was born, in 1983 with Talking Heads. And this was his return. And it was one of our first New York gigs. We were on tour for so long before we did any New York gigs, really. And so this gig was one of the first times, like a lot of my family and a lot of my friends saw it. And this is the part of the show where he introduces each of us. That's me. Come on, Unison. It's also amazing to watch these versions of the show, because we're much better at them now. You know, we did like a whole Broadway run in one theater so that we were able to refine. But I love seeing this choreography in this space, because look, you can see how the small kinesphere stuff, really tiny stuff to the body, operates and translates in such a huge, I mean, this was a stadium. There were like 18,000 people there. Like, I just love that. Annie B's work is so subtle and beautiful and effective. Look at those tiny little movements and how they just translate so well. Get it, get it. Also, I mean, this song's fucking incredible too, and mysterious and bizarre and amazing. And it's insane that it's on the set list. I love it. Okay, this part of the choreography with the little hand running movement is so difficult. It looks easy. We do the same arm phrase, but then we add a slow head that's counter to the arms. And we're better at it now, but I can't help, I'm dance captain. I can't help but like critique ourselves as we're watching this. Again, the best versions of the performances of this concert are in the Spike Lee film, I will say. But I love that this record exists of all these other gigs that we did, because they were just so special. Oh my God. Forest Hills, that was my favorite gig of my entire career. That was the most thrilling performance of my career. Yeah, definitely. Okay, one more. Okay, I'm gonna end with this one just because it's another epic venue, one of the most incredible venues ever. And it's like I think this is our finale, our second to last song. And I choreographed this number also. As you know, I did some marching band stuff growing up. Annie B wanted a marching band number and was like, can you just make it? And so I did. So this is at Red Rocks, which is a natural amphitheater in Colorado. And I love this video, I mean, because you could see just the hype and energy and the sweat. It's real. I love it because it pans out at one point to the audience. This epic canyon and 10,000 people just having the time of their lives. Look at a little marching band. Making my marching band teacher, Mr. Martin Ellen, proud. Okay, check this. Look, this is who we're performing for. Look. Shut the fuck up. Like, can you see them? Can you see how far back they go? You can't. But it's... Yep, that's Red Rocks. We performed there. It was real. Yeah! Look at me jumping. Look at those people. Look at those happy people. Yeah, it's one of the best gigs of my life. I miss this. We'll get back to it. That was, thank you for joining me on this journey of reliving some of my favorite live performances I've done. Just thank you again to everyone that has gotten vaccinated, everyone that is a healthcare worker that is helping stop this pandemic to allow people like me who do this for a living to return to the stage and to share this with you, to be in person with you again.
you don't realize how much you miss it until you, like, check in with these clips, you know, and, like, really see yourself, see what... Ugh. I have a whole playlist of live performances that Kimberly has done, and I'll link some of my favorite American Utopia clips down below and some of the other things that I showcase in this video. If you can, come see American Utopia live on Broadway. Our first preview is September 17th. It's gonna feel good. It's gonna feel good to get back out there and to be there with you. So please, and go support other live theater and performance and dance and music if you can. Be safe, follow the guidelines. Don't go out if you don't feel like you can, don't feel like it's a safe situation, depending on where you are. But if we get our shit together and everybody starts wearing masks, as they say on WWOZ, get out there and support some live local music and performance and theater and dance and everything. And wear a mask, for fuck's sake. Okay. I'm Kimberly Clark. Bye. Okay. Oh God, how did she do? Oh, Krusty McCrusterson. Honey, I'm done.